Hey, everybody. Ham Radio Now, episode 5 is on the internet. Okay. In this episode, we are going to talk about the new digital edition of QST, which starts this June. I have a good long conversation with Bob Inderbitzen, NQ1R, up at ARRL headquarters. This is going to be my first Skype interview. Turns out it's my first radio interview because we had such a bad Skype connection that his picture started out bad and ended up being frozen for most of the interview, well, all the rest of the interview. So you'll see me moving and you'll see some other stuff that we've tossed in, but anytime that Bob is on, it's just a radio show. Don't need to see any more about that because that's what this episode is all about. But I do want to promote a couple things coming up next week. On Monday, if everything works out, I'm heading up to Washington, D.C. to interview Brennan Price. Brennan is just back from the World Radio Conference, WRC-12, bringing back a brand new ham band. That should be pretty interesting. Something down in the 472 kilohertz range. Not authorized by the FCC yet, but something about that is going to be coming up. And we'll find out how that happened in the next episode when we get that all put together sometime next week. And then later on in the week, if everything goes right, I always hate to make promises, I'll talk to Dan Henderson, N1ND, up at headquarters about a couple of things, 60 meters. A lot of hams, but big changes have happened in 60 meters. We've got new modes, new power levels, some interesting things there at a new frequency. And a lot of hams are scratching their heads going, how does this work again? How do I make my radio work for these things? So we'll talk to Dan about that. And there was a little ham radio item slipped into a big bill that Congress passed recently, typically or commonly known as the paycheck bill, the payroll tax bill. And that promises to give us the potential for some antenna relief in those bugaboos that a lot of us who live in suburban developments face, the codes, covenants, and restrictions. We're a long way from any kind of resolution on that, but something has happened, and Dan Henderson knows all about it, so we'll talk to him or somebody up at headquarters and find out what that's all about. So those will be coming up in upcoming episodes next week on Ham Radio Now. And for now, let's talk to Bob Inderbitzen and find out about digital QST. So, Bob Inderbitzen, what the heck kind of call sign is that? NQ1R, is that a vanity?
No, it's not. That's the one I earned in college way back in the day.
I was going to say, it looked like a vanity, you know, being a 2x1. And I was going to say, you picked that?
Oh, I know.
But no, they picked it for you.
Well, they say Northern Quebec's number one Romeo.
All right. And our Skype connection is terrible, at least for video. Our audio is pretty good. In fact, you're kind of pixelating and turning to fairy dust before my very eyes.
Okay.
So what we want to talk about is the new digital edition of QST
that's
coming up. And I know you had an iPad there to do a demo on, and that's not going to work very well.
No, it's not. Let's see what we can do here. This, of course, is the print edition.
Yep. Well, before we talk about the new digital edition.
Please.
You guys have been digital for a long time. I'm holding up to my camera a CD, which has got digital QST on it. So, and you've been offering stuff on the web for a while, increasingly, you know, more and more available on the web, going back into history for people to look at. So it's not like you've never had anything that is digital from QST and the other magazines before. You've got some history on that, right?
Yeah, that's right, Gary. To be a publisher like ARRL is, these days you really have to have a foot in the digital side of things. So ARRL has long been trying to develop that competency, I'll bet rather conservatively.
Another way of saying you've been learning how.
That's exactly right. You know, when your membership is $39 a year, you don't have deep pockets to throw at new technologies. But we know that as a publisher, you have to publish digitally these days as well. So that's long been the case with ARRL books that have included CD-ROMs in the back. Uh-huh. The handbook and the antenna book have long included the book on CD, which makes it very easy for folks to search through content, print a page of content to share at a club meeting, that type of thing. But what we've learned all along for the last 15 years that we've dabbled in e-publishing is that with technical content, print is king. You know, people really like having a schematic diagram open to them. But one of the things that you really get out of digital is the convenience, the search capability, accessing it anywhere. So I think we're on the verge of the best of both worlds.
And print has been king.
That's right.
There are new devices like the iPad that are coming out that may change that paradigm. Because the iPad's right. not the last thing to come out.
That's right. Imagine all those music publishers who had record stores and how they felt when overnight the table shifted and guess what? People are buying music online. Yeah. First they were stealing music online, and then folks like Apple made it so convenient to find what you wanted, that paying 99 cents or $1.50 didn't feel so bad anymore.
Yeah, and I've been, you know, drinking the Leo the Port Kool-Aid that basically says that Apple forced them, the music publishers, into a new paradigm, which was good for them.
That's right.
They took their medicine and it finally helped. Now they're selling music again instead of having it all be stolen. So you guys, I was gonna claim that you're just copying CQ because CQ went digital a couple of issues ago. But you've been working on this too long. You know, you couldn't have just turned around like this and boom. But what issue of QST will be the first one released to the public?
Yeah, thanks, Gary. June's issue of QST is our planned launch of the digital edition of QST. And, you know, I'd be incorrect to say that we're not watching what everybody else is doing out there. I probably spend more time as a marketing professional in an association paying attention to what the rest of the magazine industry is, for everything from Elle and Cosmopolitan to some of the things that didn't work out well for companies like PC Magazine and some of the other technical journals. IEEE. The American Association of Pilots. These are what we're watching. We're probably not watching so much of some of the little stuff that's going on. But those companies have deeper pockets, much more investment in what they want to do, and are making mistakes. So for the last 2 or 3 years, we've been following a lot of what the industry's been doing in journal, especially technical journal and magazine publishing.
And what have they been doing?
Well, first of all, they've been making a lot of mistakes. One of the things that we found was that there are some companies that had got excited about digital, meaning that they were going to save a lot of money, and they rolled out digital magazines at the expense of their print editions. In some cases, discontinuing their print editions at the same time of the rollout of their digital editions. We know from years of surveying members that QST is the number one ARRL benefit, and hams tell us where they take their QSTs with them. Yeah, they take them to club meetings. They take them into the shack. They take them into the John too. Yep. We know the importance of print, and never in any of our planning was there any interest in discontinuing. We also know that our cost of producing QST, and remember, we do a lot with $39 a year from members. We stretch that as far as we can. But we know that our upfront costs are not just the manufacturing and printing of QST, but the editing and the layout and the production and the overhead necessary to have an organization that is the clearinghouse and the vetting of amateur radio content to the community. So we knew also that we had to do this and not diminish the – we weren't going to go out and say, for instance – that now that QST is available digitally, you can sign up for $5 a year and drop the print magazine. We knew that that wasn't going to help the organization in maintaining its competencies in finding good content and publishing.
So the dues aren't going to change.
The dues are not going to change.
Whichever way you want to go.
That's right. And we know that there's a large percentage of members who are screaming for a digital edition. And we know that there's a large number of members screaming for both print and digital. And when we added those up together, we found that the best use of ARRL resources was to serve members consistently across the board with both the digital and the print. But rather passively, we're going to give members the option of opting out. We're not going to go chasing you and like maybe your bank or utility company does and say, you know, stop the paper bill coming to your mailbox. This is a technical journal. There's power of having a technical journal in your hands. We think members will benefit from having both, but we also know that that readers' preferences are changing rapidly. And if you've come into the to reading and learning like some of these young people today, and your entire reading experience has been electronic, well, you might be one of those candidates that would want to drop the print edition of QST.
So that's going to be an option. You can't.
So it's an option. You can drop the print edition at any time.
We've turned into a radio show here, by the way. You're totally frozen. We'll see if that comes back.
Thanks, Gary. But, okay, but so we're not going to wave it in front of folks all the time and say, you know, save the league money, drop out of the print edition.
Yeah. And I don't know. Would that save very much? It looks like your research has said no.
Well, first of all, as big as we think we are, we're not that big. So, you know, you reduce your print run a few thousand copies, and it doesn't necessarily add up to significant savings. It'll add up to some savings, you know, postage and printing. But right now, we're investing in publishing QST digitally, and that costs money. And right now, our plan is not to pass that cost along to members at all with a dues increase. So a few members opting out here and there that will help. We'll simply wrap those resources back into publishing.
Okay. So what is the digital QST experience going to be like? Because there's a lot of ways you could do it.
There is. In fact, Gary, I just came back from a publishing exposition in New York City where some of the biggest publishers of both magazines and books are. And one of the things I heard at that conference is that the magazine industry has really settled into a format. There's a lot of different platforms out there. ARRL hopes that it chose one of the better platforms out there, but there's a lot of platforms out there that do very much the same thing.
Can you say who the digital publisher is? QST is using Zinio.
Yeah, QST is using Nextbook.
I mean, CQ is using Zinio. So you.
Oh, okay, yeah. QST will be using Nextbook, is using Nextbook. They actually publish AOPA's magazine, and they have a fairly big newsstand of magazines and journals.
AOPA is Airline Owners and Pilots Association, I think.
That's correct.
That's probably similar size to ARRL.
You know? Actually, they're just about twice as big as ARRL, but from a standpoint of, like I said, I was at an industry meeting the other day where publishers of much bigger magazines with billions of dollars of magazine revenue were talking about the platforms that they've built internally and some of the mistakes they've built. So we really needed to go out and find somebody who does this and does this well and partner with them. So I'm excited about the platform.
What's QST going to look like on the digital media? But you know, what's my user experience going to be?
Yep. First of all, we wanted to make sure you could use it across a lot of different devices. You know, the tablet platform, for instance, has grown exponentially in the last couple of months.
Yeah, Rich Moseson, when I was talking to Rich about CQ's transition, he was saying he looked at the CQ Digital on a laptop and said,
yes.
Yeah, that looks pretty good. He looked at it on an iPad and went, whoa.
Everything looks really good on an iPad.
Yeah. And now they got the new iPad, aka the iPad 3, which is even better.
And Gary, if you're a radio amateur who met me at one of the last conventions I've attended, I just came back in February from Orlando Hamcation.
I saw you there, by the way.
Yeah. And I attended.
And congratulations on getting it right this time. I'm afraid. You've been on Ham Radio Now once before. You're at the lead of the Orlando Hamcation tour video. Where do you remember? Do you even remember?
Yes.
Yeah. To great chagrin, I'm sure. You called it the Hamvention.
That's right. That's right. I had Hamvention on my mind, and I announced on the overhead speakers at Orlando Hamcation
to God and everybody.
Instead of saying welcome to Hamcation, I said welcome to Hamvention.
And standing next to you was Peter Meyer, the
chairman, the organizer
of Hamcation, and he smiled grimly. It's on the video. Right. You can go watch over and over again if you want.
That's right. See, but now I understand how these political figures feel when they mess up on live television. So, but anyway,
it's so easy to do. And those names are so similar. And by the way, just so you don't feel too bad, I was talking again to Rich Moseson at the Charlotte Hamfest, and I said, at the Charlotte Hamvention, and then stammered and Hamfest. Oh, I got it. So you're not the only one.
Well, Hamvention's big, and it's on our mind. I know I haven't missed one in 21 years. So
we'll talk about that in a little bit, too. But since I diverted you, you were talking about the folks that you've seen at the Hamfests.
That's right. So I attended that Hamfest, and I attended one out in Monterey, California, Radio Fest, organized by the Naval Postgraduate School Amateur Radio Club. At both of and that's an interesting audience, because a lot of the folks who are members of that club out there come from Silicon Valley. So, you know, you're demonstrating something digital. You better get it right when you've got so. That's right. And what I did was I brought out iPads to demonstrate the digital edition of QST. And, you know, folks were very impressed with it, anxious and excited about when it was going to happen, how soon they could get it, curious about how we organized this new membership benefit, how much it was going to cost them. Folks were very surprised to see that this was not going to be handled as an a la carte, but that all members would have access to it. And it looks real good on an iPad. I use it already in a beta mode the last couple of months on my laptop, and most of the staff here at ARRL are testing on PCs and tablets. It looks real good. Nextbook is also constantly changing its platform to take advantage of the best technologies out there. And I think even before it gets rolled out, we know that there'll be some enhancements to the Nextbook platform, including swiping of pages, much like you can do on an iPad, so that if you're on a tablet, whether it's an Android or an iPad, you'll be able to swipe pages to flip them. It's got a very simple menu system, accessible both through a top-level menu bar on the PC version or an embedded menu on the iPad and Android version.
It's going to be a little bit more than just a digital version of the magazine.
That's right. You know, it's a highly processed file that is not going to give you an experience of just a scanned page of QST. I mean, we're talking about really, really being able to zoom in on images and text and read it very comfortably on a device. I'm actually using it also on my Android compatible HTC cell phone. I don't suggest reading a magazine cover to cover on your smartphone, but you know, to quickly look up a result at a contest, a date on a Hamfest calendar, an article where you want to mention an author's name or a particular reference, you know, you have full capability of being able to search QST and its archive on just about any device.
Okay, so it's going to be enhanced. But the layout will still be magazine-like?
Yeah, this is what the magazine industry continues to navigate a bit. And right now, most of the magazine industry has settled into a magazine-like experience. So if you're used to flipping through QST, you'll find flipping through the digital edition very much comparable. There'll be some enhanced content. We'll be able to embed video. We'll be able to embed audio. We'll be able to expand some content to lengthier articles where maybe we didn't have the luxury of doing that in the print edition. And some of that will give, there'll be some differences then between the print and the digital.
So there's going to be some serious reasons to want to become digital for those folks that are kind of dragging their heels. And I imagine that over time, that those reasons are just going to become more and more.
Yes, Gary, and I think there's a number of them. You know, one of those is the timeliness of QST. QST drops from printers from a printer that then mails it out and does so over the course of about 5 or 6 days, trying to get it into everyone's hands domestically within about a day or two of each other. It's not a perfect system. We know the U.S. Postal Service is not a perfect system. I believe that we're going to settle into a fixed date every month to notify members that the current digital edition of QST is available. And then whether you're here or in Sudan, you'll be able to pull up QST and begin enjoying it right away.
Yeah. Now QST is mailed. What do they call that now? Third class or something? It's not.
Yeah, a periodical class of mailing. Yep.
And it's at least a week, I think. From you send it off to the printer, and it's a couple of weeks before anybody gets it in their mailbox. And my experience leads me to believe that my mailman enjoys reading QST cover to cover before he brings it to my door. He's when I've seen him on the street now and then, I didn't ask him that, but he has asked about the ham radio stuff. So I'm pretty sure he reads it because people on the local repeater talk about articles that they're seeing, and I'm going, what QST? I haven't seen it yet.
Sure, Gary. Yeah.
So you could have it out a couple of weeks before the paper print magazine hits people's mailboxes. Is it going to be published as instantly as possible, or is it going to take? Are you going to hold it back a little bit so that the magazine folks aren't totally left in the dust?
Yeah, we're gonna play with that a little bit, but the timing is going to be fairly close to when folks start to receive it in their mailbox. Here's my ideal scenario would be that when the first person receives their print copy of QST, the same day they'll receive their notification that QST is also available online. We're gonna have to play with that a little bit to try to get that, but we also don't we also know that there's something very powerful and good about QST in the mailbox, and we don't want to undermine that. We don't want to undermine that for our readers, since QST is written around the timeliness in the mailbox. But we also don't want to undermine advertisers, people who put in a coupon or the introduction of a radio, that they need to know when QST reaches readers. And so it's a collaborative effort to make sure we both satisfy members of the advertising base and the editing population that contributes to QST. But I think if you're receiving QST around mid-month before the month of publication, you'll see us settle into a date around mid-month before the month of publication.
Okay, so at least I'm going to get my digital edition while my mailman is still reading my print copy.
That's right. And I want to add, we have a staff person here at ARRL headquarters, Amy Hurtado, KB1NXO. Amy worries about QST delivery to all 158,000 of our members. So if you're one of those people that just have a problem with mail delivery in your area, let us know. You can always email circulation@arrl.org. And we'll help research that a little bit and follow it to try to solve it. We can't solve all the problems of the U.S. Postal Service, but I want you to know that we worry about the delivery of QST to every mailbox.
Yeah, but the digital edition is going to change the need for doing that.
That's right.
I can understand why you're going to hold it off until the folks get it in their mailboxes, because we don't want to make anybody mad. And the benefit right now is new. So folks really don't have much of a leg to stand on to say, well, I'm mad because I'm not getting it as fast as I possibly could. But that's a paradigm I expect will change over time as the value of the really speedy delivery. On the other hand, I can see Steve Ford saying, no, I want that week to be able to put more stuff into QST. You know, don't make me send it earlier. Just give me more time to publish it. Well, we'll publish it later when it's when everybody's doing digital.
I think most of the folks on Steve Ford's side of the equation who work tirelessly every month under deadline to publish QST have found that publishing digitally isn't as seamless as everyone will tell you. I mean, they're now, of course, concerned with the benefit of digital means you can put extra content in it. You can take advantage of that digital medium.
But that's more work.
That means more work. The cost associated with publishing digitally, you know, it's not served on ARRL servers. It's served in that big cloud out there. So that when 50,000 people decide to open their digital edition at the same time, you're not going to be cratering the ARRL system. You'll be accessing it from much, much greater, larger infrastructure. But I think the experience is going to be very, very, very good.
Better, I hope, than the Skype experience that we're having
here. I sure hope so,
Gary.
We've
still got a radio show on this end. You see any picture from me? Am I moving to you?
I do.
Yeah. Yeah, you've been a freeze frame for a while here. It's not too bad, but I may replace this with a stock publicity photo of you.
Okay, sounds fair enough.
All right, so it's going to be magazine-like, but it is going to have enhanced content as much as you can cram in and afford to be able to do.
That's right.
And it's going to come out about the same time as the regular magazine, at least for now. And it's not going to cost any more, but it's also not going to cost any less to drop the what I call, and I could not get Rich Moseson to call, the Dead Tree Edition. Can I get you to say that? Can I get you to call it Dead Tree Edition?
Oh, you know, if you want to opt out of QST because you're going to read that digital edition from cover to cover,
yeah.
Save a tree. Yeah. I'll be the first to say save a tree. Yeah. You're talking to the right person when you I'm sort of an ego guy, but you know, like we've learned from people who publish the New England Medical Journal and other digital magazines like that, this is technical content, and sometimes seeing that spread that's been laid out by people here at ARRL who really know how to lay out technical content, sometimes that can't be presented in a digital format as well as it can by enjoying the look and feel of that paper.
But if you need a schematic or something on a page, you can print. I'm sure you can print from this.
Yeah. Yes, you can. Yep. You can print. You can print pages. I've already tried out some of the offline capability of the magazine. Some people will want to put it right on their PC. So they can enjoy reading QST when they're on a plane and not connected electronically.
Yeah, it's going to be another question. You don't have to have an internet connection you can download it. You can download it and archive it and store it and do whatever you want, I guess.
That's right. The tricky part is serving all of the different devices and platforms that are out there. So expect that we're not going to get that right in the very beginning, but we're going to, at least from the start, I believe the plan is to make sure that if you have an iPad, that you're able to download it and use it offline on your iPad. And if you use a PC or Macintosh desktop or laptop computer, you'll be able to download it onto those devices. If you have an Android or Android-like compatible device, they're not quite there yet with a good download experience, but they'll get there.
Yeah, I've got a Kindle Fire. I'm cheap.
Yes. Yeah, so. It looks really good on a Kindle Fire, but I've only used it on a Kindle Fire online.
Do you know offhand how big a file a typical magazine ends up being?
I don't, Gary. I don't. I know that because of the capability of being able to zoom in very, very finely into content to read it, and because of the embedded video and images throughout the magazine, these are big files. I would say that on a T1 connection where I downloaded QST onto my PC, my desktop PC, it took around a minute.
So, that ends up being a pretty big file. These days, that's kind of irrelevant for most of us. But doing this video show, I have gotten mail from folks that say, I'm out here in the backwoods, and my internet connection is either iffy or dial-up, iffy dial-up, and so not everybody is totally connected. But at this point, we pretty much I think all we can do is feel bad for those folks, but we got to move on.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be difficult to chase every internet type connection that's out there. And of course, the industry is driving this, and not ARRL, the publishers of platforms for reading ebooks and magazine content are really driving this technology. Our hope is just always to have enough of a foot or 2 feet in the game to make sure that we can deliver the best option to members.
Let's see if there's a few more I's we can cross and T's we can dot. QST has never been available as a just subscription, except perhaps to libraries.
That's correct. QST is tied tightly to ARRL as a membership benefit. It's even written into our bylaws that way. So, there will be people out there that want to get QST, just QST without all the benefits. We have integrated this as tightly as possible with the user experience of a member to our website. So, for instance, if you're a member and you forgot your email message that tells you where to download the current edition from, you'll always be able to go to the ARRL website to the /QST page and find the current edition and all the archives located there. So we've tied this very tightly to the membership experience and to the membership experience of a logged-in ARRL website user.
Now, speaking of archives, the announcement about the digital QST also talked about enhanced archive access.
That's right. In fact, the members will have the benefit of about 6 months of QST, January through June, when this goes live, because we've been beta testing this for a number of months now. So we've been able to develop a start of an archive going forward. So on this new platform, expect that you'll be able to get January 2012 all the way through June when this goes live in this new exciting format. And that archive is only going to grow and grow and grow. Expect also that the old archive that we've been serving will continue to exist, but it's going to be brought up to date to 2011, all the way through December 2011. Members beginning June will have access to QST from December 1915 all the way through June 2012. Again, two archives, but over time we'll start to think about whether it's economically feasible and a benefit that members would want if we continue to reprocess old editions of QST in this new platform. I know it's an expense that we can't take on right now, but it's something that we're looking at.
Now, old QST, going back to the beginning, has been available on CD for some time. I think I got the whole collection. Is that still available, or are you discontinuing that to go to just online archive?
Sure. At least for now, while there's demand for an annual compilation CD, we'll continue to publish that. There's no plans presently to discontinue the annual CD-ROM. There's some convenience in that. We're actually at the point now, though, that because of the higher amounts of data that we try to pack onto an annual CD in order to retain good images and lots of text and search capability, that I think we're going to need to move off of one single CD annually and maybe onto a DVD. But we're going to continue to publish that annual CD. Remember also that the annual CD also includes all of QEX and NCJ on it too. So there's a slight advantage of being able to enjoy those other two publications as well.
Will QEX and NCJ join QST as an online digital?
I think that's the next logical step for us, Gary, after we take care of QST. And I would expect that we'd probably look at a model that would give access to the current editions and archive to existing current subscribers of QEX and NCJ. So a member just as a general regular member of ARRL would have access to QEX and NCJ in the future if they're current subscribers of those publications. That's the model that we're probably looking at. That's the model that seems to be the fairest. If you're currently subscribing to it, you'll enjoy the benefit of being able to enjoy previous editions.
Yeah. So those magazines are extra cost. They have been extra cost for print
when
you subscribe to them. You get them as a package if you buy the annual CD or about to be DVD compilation. But if you want digital, then it's still going to cost a little bit extra because it's, you know, something extra.
That's right. And again, because all this technology is changing so much, we're going to function very conservatively in this. We're not going to rush to discontinue things or until we really understand exactly what members' reading preferences are. So we published the 2011 annual CD-ROM compilation, and there's plans to do it again at the end of 2012, and then we'll reevaluate going forward.
Very exciting.
Yeah, it is.
When I was talking to Rich Moseson in a very long interview in episode 2 back at the Orlando Hamcation, I also talked to him about television because printing digital, is getting into new medium. And you probably will have some video included as well, at least the ability to access video. But we've got this new medium of television that's only been around since sometime in the late 1920s that seems like suddenly become available to everyone. If you've watched anything on YouTube,
yes.
Watch me on YouTube. You know, you can tell anybody can play. What are you guys doing up there about television?
Yeah, not too much, but let me start first with the digital edition of QST. Yes, it will have embedded video in it. We'll continue to publish to the ARRL website in video. We'll continue to publish to ARRL's YouTube channel, which is ARRLHQ. We'll continue to publish to that YouTube channel, but expect that QST, where we talk about a product review, we'll have Bob Allison doing the product review right on that page where you can launch the video. I think television is an interesting medium. I think it's very exciting that the amateur radio community has embraced with so many different homegrown television productions out there. It's exciting. It's clearly a great way to deliver content, tell the story of amateur radio, excite prospective hams about our storytelling. But from a standpoint of delivering a lot of content, it's not a particularly efficient medium for some of the meaty content that you find on the printed page. I don't think people are going to...
It sort of has its own place. For example, an interview like this would never end up in a magazine.
That's right, Gary. We could have filled up a page, I'm sure.
Yeah, no kidding. So this is something that television can do pretty well, or in this case, radio.
That's right.
That can do better because it's just kind of it's a banter. We're having a conversation. Hard to do in a magazine.
It's entertaining, both for the interviewee and the listener.
Yeah. And the magazine can be entertaining too.
That's right.
Going all the way back to The Old Man, QST has had stuff in it that's not purely technical. I mean, I write a lot for QST, and I don't write anything that's technical because I am not an engineer. I am king of the appliance operators.
Yes.
But that is valuable to a substantial base of the ARRL membership, and so they have me write something once in a while from that perspective, and I'm happy to, and I try to make it entertaining. But, I'm an old TV guy. TV is, for me, it's where it's at. Well, tell you what, in doing ham radio now, and I've seen you on over on HQA radio, and I hear you on the Rain Report, and you're probably, everybody taps you for stuff. but I am happy to make ham radio now as available to ARRL as I possibly can. So if there's anything going on, I'll probably be knocking on your door more than you're knocking on mine, but...
Well, thank you, Gary.
Certainly be here as long as this thing works, and we'll do as much of a partnership as we can. In fact, I was talking to Dan Henderson on the phone a little bit earlier. I wanted to include two more segments in this episode. I wanted to talk about 60 meters, and I wanted to talk about this payroll tax thing that has got a little ham radio rider in it. And Dan is so busy writing about both of those things for upcoming QSTs that he wasn't going to be able to talk now, but he promised next week. So we'll do a teaser on those. There's been a lot written about both, but there's more information that's available. And I think on 60 meters, a lot of hams are scratching their heads going, what? So next week on Ham Radio Now, we should have an episode with Dan and maybe a few other folks talking about that stuff.
Very good. Yeah, Dan is definitely the one to talk to about those issues. And at the same time, I know there's already some good content published to the ARRL website to keep people in the loop as all of this develops.
Yeah, and he's got a big article on 60 meters in the April issue that just arrived in my mailbox yesterday. So
that's right. Pretty soon you'll be saying in your inbox.
Yeah, that'll be good. And there's another issue. I don't know how much you know about this. When Brennan Price came back from Geneva, was mm-hmm. he hailed as the conquering hero bringing back a new ham band? Because he should have been.
Yes. I mean, we're all really proud.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's what happens when you're at the table, right? More than so that at the table. I mean, Brennan's a willing partner and participant in that entire process. So, yeah, it's pretty exciting.
Yeah. Now, it's a 7 kilohertz wide ham band, I should mention. That's kind of an arrow, and it's down at 470 or so kilohertz. Yep. So
just to be in a position where we're talking about expanding the ham bands is exciting enough for a lot of us who've been hams for decades.
Yeah, and don't fire up your loafer radio right now, because it's not a ham band in the U.S. It's not a ham band any place right now. What it has is international approval from the help me out here. The ITU. There we go. The ITU has basically said, okay, this is a secondary ham band in terms of our international allocations, and now it's up to each country to make their rules for what it's going to be and what can be used, but it is available. And I'm going to try to get somebody from headquarters to talk to me more about it. But I guess the next step is somebody's got to petition the FCC to say, okay, let's use it. Well, who could possibly do that?
Yeah.
Maybe ARRL.
And I know,
a bunch of other people will, too.
Yeah, and I know Dan will be able to speak to that a lot better than I could. So yeah.
I'd love to get Brennan. I don't know how.
I don't know
if I've got the juice to bring Brennan in here. is he based in Washington?
Yeah, ARRL's Virginia office. That's correct.
That's driving distance for me. I might.
That's right. Yeah.
I can twist his arm and let me go up there and not do it on frozen Skype.
Yeah, Brennan started to feel like a resident of Switzerland after all of those meetings. So,
but he's back. So
he's back. And he is the conquering hero. So we're real proud of the work he does.
So that'll be very cool. Before we go, I want to know a little bit more about Bob Inderbitzen. Let's flesh you out as a human being. You are the marketing what? What's your official title?
I am the sales and marketing manager, the sales and marketing department manager, and I call myself the marketing manager because who wants to talk to a sales manager? But I call myself the marketing manager here at ARRL. And I've been here about 21 years.
Holy cow.
And it's a long time, but I'm a long-time ham even before that, and I feel strongly about the work being done here.
I know some of the hams, most of the employees at headquarters are hams, not all of them. The last time I visited, I did an annoying video where I was asking people if they were active on ham radio or not. I don't know, some people are and some people are not. Harold Kramer has a little column about having just about completed, I guess he just completed 5-band DXCC. So he's clearly an active ham.
Yeah, he's active.
Do you get to spend much time on the air?
Is that much
of a business for you?
No. I don't spend as much time on the air as I'd like.
But I
find that a lot of our members too. As much as I like to think that our members eat, sleep, and drink ham radio, there are periods of time when your reminder of your membership and your activity in amateur radio is QST in your mailbox. Probably one of my passions in amateur radio is portable operating. I vacation as a lucky New Englander. I vacation with my family on Cape Cod. And one of my favorite places to operate is from Marconi Beach in Wellfleet, Massachusetts. There's a rare grid square that hangs out on the coast there a little bit. And there's been a number of times when I've dragged a car battery and my portable HF station and a fishing pole and a lot of wire and dipoles and set that up on the beach there. There's even been a couple of instances where the park ranger has met me at the gate at sunrise and said, "Hey, you're one of those ham guys, right?" He said, "Can I help you, professor, get your equipment down to the beach?"
All right.
Yes, please help me get down to the beach with all this stuff. So
what bands do you operate when you do that?
So when I'm doing portable operating, I'll usually operate HF, and I do a little bit of 2 and 6 meter operating.
HF is big. I mean, do you hang out on 20 or do you spread out a little bit?
Yeah. I would say 15, 20, and 40 is probably.
Now we're talking like hams. We're not talking like business people.
That's right. And you know what was funny is this past year when I went on vacation there and set up the station, I set it all up. And, you know, I'm clearly on vacation. You know, I'm wearing my flip-flops and my bathing trunks, and I'm all set up on the beach there. And my first contact was a guy on the Canary Islands. And he said, "Hey, I'm wearing flip-flops and I'm on vacation here in the Canary Islands." So
perfect.
Anyway, so
are you doing this QRP or
yeah, just barefoot with whatever the car battery will help drive on my radio. So
what kind of radios do you take?
I use an IC706.
Okay. So you could do probably not quite 100 watts without a
not quite.
Just the battery by itself, but 50 watts or so.
That's right.
And
so that's a lot.
What kind of antenna do you stick up?
So I bring a couple of multiband dipoles with me. I've borrowed from the ARRL lab some good 2 and 6 meter Yagis that I've been able to mount. I guy my fishing pole with, you know, those green shopping bags people carry to the supermarket these days. Mm-hmm. I bring a lot of rope with me, and those bags fill them with sand, and it works outstanding. So you know, I'm not a real good operator. I say that I probably turn to the ARRL operating manual, and when I put a connector on a piece of coax, probably the handbook more times than most of the staff here at headquarters. But I can follow a recipe.
And sideband CW, what modes are your favorites?
Yeah, I'm actually a pretty good CW operator, and it's a shame because I don't operate CW enough. I'm fairly comfortable with a key or a bug, but most of the time I'd say I operate sideband voice.
So it's possible to find NQ1R.
It's possible. You know, I still occasionally get a couple cards from the bureau. So yeah, it is.
Do any contesting?
You know, I haven't done much contesting in the last couple of years, but I had long been associated with a group of radio amateurs at Worcester Polytechnic Institute in Worcester, Mass. And from time to time would drop in on their November sweepstakes operation. So, but that's a number of years. And but November sweepstakes is a favorite. As a staff person at ARRL, a lot of us take enjoy during field day weekend traveling from site to site. And that's just fun.
I was going to ask you what you would be doing on the fourth rainy weekend in June.
In June, yeah. Probably visiting some of the Connecticut, Massachusetts radio clubs out here, unless I'm traveling. There's been a couple of instances where I found myself at the Big Ham Radio Convention in Friedrichshafen on the same weekend as field day. So that's been disappointing that I haven't been able to always participate in field day for that reason. And at the same time, there's nothing better than being at a big ham radio convention in Europe.
But you have traveled site to site in some years around New England, I guess.
That's right.
I've done that a little bit when I was editing a magazine down here, a regional magazine, and it was fascinating. If you've only been to your own local club or maybe one or two local clubs' field days. Seeing what everybody else does, nobody does it the same. Everybody does it different.
Yeah, they do. And folks like visitors to show up. You know, people work really hard to put together a good field day operation. And, you know, when somebody from ARRL headquarters comes or even just members of the amateur radio community drop in to see how things are going, you know, that means a lot. The folks like to tell their story. And, you know, the other reason I have to say is I like to eat their food.
That's a benefit. Usually a benefit. Can be
That's
a little
right.
dangerous, but
That's right.
Watch especially the watch, on Sunday. Watch, you don't want to eat any of the food on Sunday.
Watch the chili, because some people have some pretty vicious versions of chili out there on field day.
Well, down here in North Carolina, our section manager travels to as much field territory as he can. The South Carolina section manager spends some time in North Carolina, and the North Carolina spends some time in South Carolina, because these are wide states. And he's out west, and our guy is east, so they cover some of both of each other's states. Yeah, and you're right. We love it when they come to visit the field day site. We love showing it off to them. We love showing it off to the general public. This is outside the purview of this discussion, but as long as I've got an audience here, we're not very good at showing it off in way too many cases. We use jargon. You know, we tell people that this station is operating sideband and that one's operating CW, and these people got question marks over their head like the cartoons going, I don't know what this guy's talking about, but I'm not
We're ask. We're a hobby and an avocation of acronyms, and we need to be hypersensitive of that when we talk to the general public.
Well, I'll drag Alan Pitts on here sometime.
Yes.
And we'll talk about that, because his PIO Corps is trying desperately to figure out a better way to talk to the public, and
you know, there's a audio clip on the ARRL website under the Media and Public Relations section, which is a short what we call an elevator. You've heard this one, Gary, I'm sure. It's a short elevator talk that a young man had put together on, you know, how to describe amateur radio in a minute or less when you're in the elevator with somebody who's not a ham.
I know the concept. I know what I've done. What do you remember what he did?
Oh, he nailed it. I mean, he just represented amateur radio so well. If you struggle when somebody asks you the question, tell me, what do these ham radio operators do? Aren't those old guys in the basement or the attic that – and if you struggle with navigating the answer to that question, go to the public service part of the ARRL website and download that young man's audio clip and memorize it. He did such an outstanding job on describing our avocation.
Amateur or ham radio is a fun hobby for all ages and walks of life, in which we can talk to people around the world or across town with a simple radio and antenna. We also work with various agencies to provide real-time information in the event of a natural disaster. On the local scale, hams voluntarily provide communications for events such as bike rides and marathons. You know, ham radio is for people just like you. I hope you want to learn more.
After I heard it, what I said was, you know, we're too quick to jump to the word hobby. You know, this is a service of people who span the gamut from technical to public service to their enjoyment of talking to people around the world. Those are all things written into the federal code of why the amateur radio service in the United States exists. So there are ways to tell that story very quickly and in a fun, exciting fashion that might draw somebody else into the amateur radio service.
Yeah, the phrase that I've come up with is that ham radio is a two-way radio, and we forget about that two-way part, a two-way radio hobby and service. I say it's a hobby because we do it for fun. We do it because this is something we love to do. It's a service because we provide public service. We're licensed by the FCC. We have to take an exam. And we provide both emergency and event-based public service. So in using our capabilities and our equipment, we have fun and we do something worthwhile. And that from that little bit, and I'll see if the fellow that you're talking about has got me beat. From that little bit, it opens up lots and lots of questions, and you can start filling things in. But you have to start small. Too often as somebody says, well, tell me about this ham radio, and we open the fire hose at them.
Yeah, please don't start with a model, make and model number of your radio and the type of antenna and the length of it. You'll just scare them away.
Yeah. So you're going to be at the Hamvention, this time?
That's right. So this will be my 21st year at Dayton Hamvention, and I'm responsible for organizing ARRL's big exhibition area, ARRL Expo at Hamvention.
That is
huge. And it's huge, and it's fun. I was just looking at our team registration forms, which include both staff, ARRL officials, and other member volunteers who have said that they want to help out the ARRL Expo area. And we're already approaching 100 folks just working in our space. So so come to Hamvention and be sure to stop by the ARRL Expo. We like to call it a show within a show.
It is. You take up a lot of space, and it is always crowded. And you do a bunch of things there that are unique to the ARRL Expo area. Maybe you can touch on a couple of them, little highlights.
Yeah, just very quickly, this year, Alan Pitts, the media PR and media manager for ARRL, has organized a stage with the Media and Public Relations Committee. The stage will have presentations on it round the clock about do-it-yourself projects. Some of the ARRL community knows that this year ARRL has a public relations campaign built around interesting the do-it-yourself community in amateur radio, makers, hackers, do-it-yourselfers.
Yeah, there's that new video that they've got out.
That's right. So we're going to make that a stage at Dayton, and we've invited a bunch of radio amateurs to give short presentations around the clock on all the cool technology, microprocessors, satellite tracking, all the cool stuff radio amateurs are doing. And the hope is that we just inspire even longtime radio amateurs and new radio amateurs with some of the cool technology that is within arm's reach of all of us.
And we won't reach the community that we are trying to reach in terms of the maker community, because they won't be there. But I guess we will learn what we can reach out to that maker community. Because, I mean, these are the people that that already sort of the do-it-yourself. And do-it-yourself could be anywhere from macrame to robotics to electronics. And so not every one of those people is going to be interested in ham radio. But many of them are of that mindset, and all they need to know is a little bit more about what we are and what we can offer them, and some of them will say, cool, I want to do that. I want to add that to my do-it-myself.
We want makers and hackers and do-it-yourselfers to be a part of our community because they help advance the technology that we enjoy as radio amateurs. The stuff that we do enjoy as appliance operators often starts in somebody's garage or basement as a small project, right? I mean, that's me. I remember when I first got on packet radio too many years ago to admit, that was really raw, novel technology that we were doing with simple circuits and tying them to our HTs and being able to keyboard a few words back and forth on our TRS-80s and Commodore computers. That was really cool technology. And now look, today you can, as a radio amateur, if you can buy a box that manages all the different digital modes, interfaces very easily with your appliance box, and we're having great fun with it. Well, in a couple of years, we're going to be bored of it, and we want some makers and hackers and DIYers to take it to the next.
The next, and there the internet disappeared entirely. Let's see if he comes back.
Me?
And I think you've arrived back. Take it to the next.
Okay.
And I think the word that came after next was level.
Yeah, we want the makers and hackers and DIYers to take it to the next level. We want them to say, okay, so here's a snapshot of amateur radio today, and look at what else you can do with it when you cobble together some of this technology and some of these wires and some of these boxes together with what you're already doing. These are innovators, and I probably want some of the more exciting areas that these folks are working in is microprocessor technology, using things like the PIC microprocessor chip and the Arduino microprocessor, which is popular in the make community, and able to do some really neat things, everything from APRS at a very small level so that you can use it on weather balloons and model rocketry, to modifying existing Linksys router gear for amateur radio use.
It's unlimited. Do anything you want.
It really is, and what that community doesn't all know exists is that there's these cool frequencies that the radio amateur service have.
We can transmit.
And we can transmit. We can make your fun electronic project wireless. And the amount of frequency access that we have means that you can turn something into something that you can do across the room to, you know, around town. And that's pretty exciting.
Yep. Well, Bob, I really appreciate talking to you. We've been on for quite a bit of time. I think I'm going to stick it all up into an episode. And I'm looking forward to seeing you at the Dayton Hamvention and other hamfests across the country.
Well, Gary, thank you. Thanks for all you do to represent the amateur radio service to ARRL members and prospective amateur radio operators around the world. Thank you.
And I will see you soon. 73.
All right. 73s.
Well, thank you, Bob. That was a great and long interview, but I had a lot of fun. Looks like you were having fun. Thanks to the audience, those of you that have stuck it out all the way to the bitter end here. Appreciate you watching this far. A lot of you have expressed an interest in seeing these long interviews, these conversations, and hopefully you're having a good time. Let me remind you that we are still looking for our 10,000 hams at $10 a year to help keep these things on the internet. So if you're willing to help out and haven't done so far, stop by arvn.tv, click the pig. Yeah, come on in, Arvin. Come on, yeah, say hi. Click the pig, and you can make a contribution to keep ARVN online. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4EQ. We'll see you next time. Over and out.